Okay, I was going to, we'll just go straight into the sermon. I was going to preach on eternal security, just to preach on something like that might help us answer questions out soul winning. I was talking with my wife last night and we were talking about something and I felt like I needed that reminder. So maybe, you know, what we talked about, maybe I'll remind the church as well and just tell you what we were talking about, what I was thinking about last night. So today I wanted to preach about the life of King Solomon, you know, the life of King Solomon and some of the principles that we can learn from the life of King Solomon. So I named this sermon, Let Us Hear the Conclusion. So that for those of you who are familiar with Ecclesiastes 12, you know what that conclusion is. So hopefully you don't just switch off thinking, oh, you know, I know King Solomon, I already know everything about King Solomon, I already know what the conclusion is, rather than take this as a reminder today of what that conclusion is. Maybe some of you here are not that familiar with the life of King Solomon and some of the stories there, so this sermon might be interesting for you to learn a bit more about who he was and his experiences as a king and the lessons that he was really trying to leave with people through the experiences he had in his life. So number one is, who is King Solomon? If you don't know who King Solomon was the son of King David. So he was the third king of Israel, you know, just before it split, because it was his son Rehoboam that, you know, sort of split ways with Jeroboam, and you have the kingdom divided into Israel and Judah. So if you're wondering where to find these stories in the Bible, the easiest way to think of it is, you know, you have 1 and 2 Samuel and then you have 1 and 2 Kings. Really, 1 Samuel is about Saul and then 2 Samuel is about King David and then 1 Kings is about Solomon. And then you have your parallel stories in the books of Chronicles. So if you're always wondering, oh, you know, I want to read up about King Solomon, where do I go? You just go to 1 Kings. That's generally where he starts. You know, 1 Samuel is, you know, the prophet Samuel and then Saul. And then you have 2 Samuel was King David and a lot of his stories there. So let's go to a few key stories. I'm not going to go over the whole life of King Solomon. Let's go to a few key stories so we can learn a few things about King Solomon tonight. So we'll go to 1 Kings 3 verse 5. And really, you know, so Solomon is appointed king after, you know, by David. And he first has this sort of little tussle with another one of David's sons. So I won't go into that, but that's 1 Kings 1 and 2. And then you get into 1 Kings 3, where Solomon has this dream. And this is one of the very famous stories about Solomon, where he has this dream where God comes to him. So let's read this in 1 Kings 3. In Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night. And God said, ask what I shall give thee. And Solomon said, so God is basically saying, ask me for something and I'll give it to you. And Solomon said, thou hast showed unto thy servant David, my father, great mercy, according as he walked before thee in truth and in righteousness and in uprightness of heart with thee. And thou hast kept for him this great kindness that thou hast given him a son to sit on his throne as it is this day. And now, O Lord, my God, thou hast made thy servant king instead of David, my father. So he's referring to himself when he says thy servant. And I am but a little child. I know not how to go out or come in. And thy servant is in the midst of thy people, which thou hast chosen, a great people that cannot be numbered nor counted for multitude. Give therefore thy servant an understanding heart to judge thy people, that I may discern between good and bad. For who is able to judge this thy so great a people? And the speech pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this thing. And God said unto him, because thou hast asked this thing and hast not asked for thyself long life, neither hast thou asked riches for thyself, nor hast thou asked the life of thine enemies, but hast asked for thyself understanding to discern judgment. Let me get a drink of water. Sorry guys, I tear up a bit when I read this passage. Just give me a second. Oh. Sorry guys, I don't know if I'm going to be able to finish this sermon. And it's one of these sermons where you wish you were in the pew for this, but it's not really what this sermon's about, but just every time I read this passage, it just really speaks to my heart because, let me finish reading this. Behold, I have done according to thy words. Lo, I have given thee a wise and an understanding heart, so that there was none like thee before thee, neither after thee shall any arise like unto thee. And I have also given thee that which thou hast not asked, both riches and honour, so that there shall not be any among the kings like unto thee all thy days. And if thou wilt walk in my ways to keep my statutes and my commandments, as thy father David did walk, then I will lengthen thy days. And Solomon awoke, and behold, it was a dream. And he came to Jerusalem and stood before the ark of the covenant of the Lord, and offered up burnt offerings and offered peace offerings and made a feast to all his servants. So this is one of the key stories in Solomon's life. And it's just such an amazing story. It just shows when Solomon started off as a king, just how he saw himself, you know, how humble he was when God asked him, you know, ask me anything you want, anything at all that you want from me, I'll give it you. And Solomon doesn't ask for honor. He doesn't ask for riches. He doesn't ask something for himself. He realizes the position that God has put him in, and what he asks for is wisdom. Just says, God, you know, I feel like I'm just a little child. How do I know how to run a kingdom, how to run these things? Give me wisdom so that I can judge so great a people. And the reason why this story just speaks to my heart, because, you know, when I started off on this journey in my Christian life, I never saw myself as being a bishop of a church. I mean, I still, you know, people call me pastor and I feel uncomfortable because I don't see myself as this great leader. But God has saw it fit in my life. I am where I am today. And, you know, when we started this church, when me and Michael were talking about it, you know, I was really fearful of what was going to happen, where this church was going to go, you know, where are the people going to come from and all these sorts of things. What are we going to do? How is God going to use me? And I just remember praying this prayer and just saying, you know, God, I don't know. I don't think I'm an eloquent speaker. I don't think I'm this great leader. I don't have great management skills. But Lord, just give me wisdom. If you're going to put me in a position where I'm going to be judging between brethren and making decisions, please give me this wisdom. And that's why this story just really speaks to me as a pastor and as a bishop, that Solomon also had, Solomon had this experience there. So it's just such an amazing story, just seeing how humble he was, how he started that way. And unfortunately, he didn't end that way. Let's go on to the next story. So the next story in 1 Kings 3, verse 16, is where he actually demonstrates this wisdom that God had given to him. It says here, then came there two women that were harlots unto the king and stood before him. And the one woman said, O my Lord, I and this woman dwell in one house, and I was delivered of a child with her in the house. And it came to pass the third day after that I was delivered, that this woman was delivered also, and we were together. There was no stranger with us in the house, save we two in the house. And this woman's child died in the night because she overlaid it, and she arose at midnight and took my son from beside me, while thine handmaid slept and laid it in her bosom, and laid her dead child in my bosom. And when I rose in the morning to give my child suck, behold, it was dead. But when I had considered it in the morning, behold, it was not my son which I did bear. And the other woman said, Nay, but the living is my son, and the dead is thy son. And this said, No, but the dead is thy son, and the living is my son. Thus they spake before the king. Then said the king, The one saith, This is my son that liveth, and thy son is the dead. And the other saith, Nay, but thy son is the dead, and my son is the living. And the king said, Bring me a sword. And they brought a sword before the king. And the king said, Divide the living child in two, and give half to the one and half to the other. Then spake the woman whose the living child was unto the king, for her bowels yearned upon her, yearned upon her son. And she said, O my Lord, give her the living child, and in no wise slay it. But the other said, let it be neither mine nor thine, but divide it. Then the king answered and said, give her the living child, and in no wise slay it. She is the mother thereof. And all Israel heard of the judgment with the king, which the king had judged, and they feared the king, for they saw that the wisdom of God was in him to do judgment. Now, I'm sure many bishops throughout time have seen the story of Solomon in 1 Kings 3 and prayed for wisdom. But unfortunately, we weren't all given the same wisdom that Solomon was given. So we have to trust the grace of God and continue to ask that, God would give us wisdom, who gives to all men liberally, as we read in James. But we see here this story where King Solomon actually demonstrates this wisdom. And if you weren't following along with what happened in the story, there's basically two prostitutes, right? Two harlots, and they each have a child each. And one of the prostitutes, in sleeping with her child, accidentally rolls over on this child and kills the child in the night. And in the morning, she goes over to the other prostitute and switches the child out while she was sleeping. And in the morning, the prostitute who didn't kill her child, she wakes up, her child is dead. But then when she looks at the child, she realizes, hey, this is not my baby, right? This is not my baby that's died. And actually, this other prostitute, she's actually stolen my baby. She's claiming it to her own. So now these two ladies have come before Solomon, right, in order to judge. And there's no witnesses to this, right? So Solomon can't get another witness to say, hey, whose baby is this and whatnot, because they're prostitutes. They probably slept with a guy that they don't even know, and they've gotten a baby from it. So then what does Solomon do? If you're following along the story, it's very interesting that he pretends, he says, bring me a sword, because he's pretending that he's going to cut this living baby in two and then just divide it in half. And everyone's probably thinking, like, this is crazy. Like, you can't just, you know, they come to you for judgment or who the baby is. You can't just cut the baby in half. Obviously, the baby's going to die, you know, and can't just give half to the baby, half to each woman. But he does something interesting here, because he's just pretending to divide it in half because it revealed the heart of the two mothers. One, her heart yearned upon the child and said, you know what, like, if you're just going to kill the child, then don't give it to me. I'd rather you just give the child to the other lady rather than kill it. Well, the other prostitute just says, you know what, just cut it in half and we'll take both. Man, it's such a chilling statement when you read that passage. You know, when you can almost, in this passage, you can see, you can feel the love of the real mother. But you know what's funny? That she was a prostitute. Yeah, she was a prostitute, no father, and yet how much did she love her child? Whereas you get Christians nowadays that are like the other lady, you know, the other prostitute, where they're just like, you know what, kill it. You know, people these days that are for abortion, just killing their babies in the womb, like, these people are not even prostitutes. These are like working class people. God forbid, they are Christian people, and they feel the same way about their babies as this wicked and evil prostitute, where they're just right, you know what, just kill it. Doesn't mean anything to me. But we ought to have this frame of mind of the prostitute that actually loved her son and was willing to sacrifice even being with her son in order to save the life of the child. So after pretending to cut this child in half and seeing the reaction from the two women, King Solomon then realizes, well, obviously, you know, I mean, he didn't just realize then, but that's what he was trying to draw out, to see, well, if I cut this child in half, which woman actually cares about the child, because that's going to be the real mother. And it's funny, because a lot of I don't know if you guys have seen, like, a lot of, like, Hollywood movies and sitcoms have actually used this scenario. I remember when I used to watch Seinfeld, right? And then, you know, there was this bicycle that Kramer had. I don't know if you guys remember that episode, if you guys used to watch it. Kramer had this bicycle, and then I think Elaine was, like, trying to pretend like it was hers. And then they bring it to Newman, and Newman's sitting there like King Solomon. And he's like, you know, what we'll do is we'll cut the bicycle in half. And then Elaine's like, you know, whatever, he can, you know, we'll just cut it in half. And Kramer's like, no, like, you know, give it to her. Don't destroy the bicycle. And he's like, oh, the real owner of the bicycle is the one that wants to preserve the bicycle. The point I'm just telling you here is, you know, obviously Seinfeld is a wicked and ungodly show, and if you guys are still watching that garbage, then you should not. But what I'm getting at here is, you know, there's no new story under the sun, is there? Like, you know, Hollywood tries to come up with all these different stories, and you think you're seeing something new, but they're just taking it from the Bible. You know, they got that scenario from the Bible of this wise king, this wise person making these wise choices. They're copying Solomon. But God came up with these things, right? God came up with these stories. He's the author of these brilliant, like, wise and the awesome stories in the Bible. And then Hollywood's just stealing them and perverting them. You know, you have things like, you think about Hercules, right? And I don't know what other long-haired strong men there are, that they have, you know, all these warriors and things have long hair. It's because they're copying Samson. You know, Samson, long hair, strong guy. Or, you know, you remember the movie 300. They got that from the Bible, Gideon and the 300. You know, it's just, they're just copying, you know, like the Matrix. You think, oh, wow, you know, Matrix, you know, this great concept. It's groundbreaking. No, hello, Savior of the world, the one. If you've not read about it before, it's from the Bible. So it's the same thing. It's like what else was there when there's a savior? You know, like Superman, Savior of the world. You know, a guy, I can't remember the planet that he's from, and sends his only son to go save Earth. You know, these narratives are all the same. There's nothing new under the sun. Just like Solomon says, they're just copying things that God has already done. And that's why the concept of intellectual property is so stupid. You know, people think they can own an idea. They can own a sequence of words. They can own a sequence of notes. They can own information. I mean, they didn't create it. Nobody really creates anything. You know, creativity is just finding a combination that nobody has discovered yet. But the combinations are there. God, you know, people just look at nature and they're just copying from God. So what gives people a right to say, this is my idea, and if anybody else copies it, then I get to charge them money for it. So I'm definitely against intellectual property. I think if somebody has an idea, they have to figure out a way to market it, because you can't tell other people what to do with their property. Anyways, I digress. Let's go to Ecclesiastes. So these are some two stories from Solomon in 1 Kings 3. God giving him wisdom in that dream, and then the story of the two prostitutes and Solomon demonstrating that wisdom that was given to him by God by saying, hey, let's cut this child in half, and then revealing which prostitute was the real mother. Now, Solomon started off well, but it didn't end well. I'm not going to go over everything, but read Ecclesiastes, you know, read the stories of Solomon, go back to it. But I want to show you this passage in Ecclesiastes 2, because see, one thing Solomon did is, you know, he had this wisdom, but what he did is he just went and just, you know, lived for the flesh. He just went out and just enjoyed anything he could, because he was so wise and he had all the money. There was nothing that was withheld from him. And one experiment he did in his life, one, it's just one of those things. It's funny. Yeah. So one of the things he did was he went out and just enjoyed and just lived it up. And we read this in Ecclesiastes 2. When he writes here, I said in mine heart, go to now, I will prove thee with mirth. So with happiness. He's saying to his heart, you know, I'm going to test out my heart and just see how happy I can make my heart. Therefore, enjoy pleasure. And he says, and behold, this also is vanity. Because Ecclesiastes, a lot of people believe that Ecclesiastes was written after, you know, at the end of Solomon's life, because he's coming to the conclusions now of what he did in his life. And he's saying here, behold, this is also vanity. What is vanity? What is something that is vain? It has no profit. It has nothing beneficial. I said of laughter, it is mad, and of mirth, what doeth it? I sought in mine heart to give myself unto wine, so just the food and the beverages, yet acquainting mine heart with wisdom, and to lay hold on folly till I might see what was that good for the sons of men, which they should do under the heaven all the days of their life. I made me great works. I builded me houses. I planted me vineyards. So what is this? He's doing the gardening, right? People that spend all their life making this perfect garden. It's funny, Peter tells me that when you go soul winning and you see a house, it just has a pristine, perfect garden. It's always a Greek person. You know, these Greek people just love their gardens. And so, you know, that's what Solomon did. You know, he had a garden that was probably 10 times more grand than any Greek person's garden you've ever seen. I made me great work. So, he's building businesses as well. You know, I made me gardens and orchards. I planted trees in them of all kinds of fruits. So maybe it's not just a garden where he's feeding himself, but maybe he's planting vineyards and orchards in order to harvest these fruits and creating businesses, trying to get pleasure from building something with his own hands and putting something together and managing a business. I made me pools of water to water therewith, the wood that bringeth forth trees. I got me servants and maidens. And had servants born in my house. Also, I had great possessions of great and small cattle above all that were in Jerusalem before me. So he's got people serving him. So not only has he tried out the pleasure of working hard and building something for yourself, but now he's also enjoyed the pleasure of just being served, just laying back. He's got all these servants waiting on him hand and foot, having all different types of animal possessions too. I gathered me also silver and gold, so even all the money and all the treasures. I gathered me also silver and gold and the peculiar treasures of kings and of the provinces. When I see these peculiar treasures of kings, it reminds me of people that collect things. You know, they want to collect numismatic coins or stamps or, you know, Nike shoes. I see like my Asian friends back like in Perth, you know, all these Asian b-ballers, right? They love like the Jordan shoes and they'll line up like these Apple fans line up outside of Apple just to get the latest Air Jordans. I don't know, that's so girly. It's so girly to be into clothes, guys. It's so girly to care about how you dress. You know, I saw this funny meme on Facebook of like a llama with like hair going over and it says like every worship leader under 30, and I just like cracked up laughing because, you know, it's girly. It's to me, it's so feminine, guys, to care about your hair, to care about your clothes, you know, wearing skinny jeans and going out. I mean, it's a girly thing to do to say, oh, you know, I really want that pair of shoes. But when guys start doing it, to me, it's, you know, like you gotta become less feminine. You know, it's a sin to be effeminate, sin to be girly. So we got to be manly because we don't want to raise. I mean, you see the kids out there in their skinny jeans and whatnot. You want the kids in church having that example? You know, we don't want people in tight, you know, women in tight clothes, guys in skinny jeans with fancy hairdos acting like a girl with makeup and whatnot and jewelry. You know, that's the example the world has. Our kids have enough example from Hollywood and the world. We don't need to give them more examples in church. Let's act like men of God and women of God and give our children that sort of example to see when they come to the house of God. I gathered me also silver and gold and peculiar treasures of kings and of the provinces. I got me men singers and women singers and the delights of the sons of men as musical instruments and that of all sorts. So King Solomon, man, he's done the clubs. He's done the nightclubs. You know, he's gone to the music concerts. He's gone to the movies and watched all of these people entertaining him. And you know what, I'll throw this in there for you guys as well. Hey, he's gone to the soccer games, right? He's gone to the football games. Hey, he's seen it all, right? There's nothing that, don't go, oh, Solomon, if he had this, what we had today, he would have enjoyed that. He would have got some pleasure from that. No. He's done everything. And the delights of the sons of men as musical instruments and that of all sorts. So I was great and increased more than all that were before me in Jerusalem. Also, my wisdom remained with me. So even after he's doing all these things, he's still the wisest man that ever lived. And whatsoever mine eyes desired, I kept not from them. And that's such an interesting statement. It's like whatever he saw, if he wanted, he got it. And we see later on when we read in Kings, he really took that to the extreme when he had 700 wives and 300 concubines. That number is mind-blowing. You know, that's almost, I mean, it's funny that, you know, that's like the sodomites these days, that they have that many different partners. You know, this is what King Solomon did. He almost like went into just sleeping with just so many people, you know, but he didn't sleep with a man, you know, he slept with women, not men. So he wasn't reprobate because he was saved. Whatsoever mine eyes desired, I kept not from them. I withheld not my heart from any joy, for my heart rejoiced in all my labor, and this was my portion of all my labor. Then I looked on all the works that my hands had wrought and on the labor that I had labored to do. And behold, all was vanity and vexation of spirit. And there was no profit under the sun. So Solomon does all these things. He builds all these businesses. He has all this pleasure, has all these women, most of the things that we get, our hearts get carried away from. When we get away from the things of God, when our love for God starts growing cold, you know what you start being tempted of. You know what you want to go back to, whatever it is, whether it's women, whether it's money, whether it's success, whether it's popularity, whether it's these things. He did all this, right? And he's saying, hey, it's all vanity and vexation of spirit. Vanity, there's no profit. There's no benefit. What is vexation of spirit? When you indulge in these things, when you actually do these things, it actually vexes your soul. It troubles you. Do you remember when Lot was in Sodom? It says he vexed his righteous soul day and night, dwelling among those people. To be vexed, it troubles you. You know, we get this idea that people who indulge in these things that they're happy. They're not happy, you know, because they'll have pleasure of sin for a season, but once that pleasure is over, there's no lasting joy. You know, people that sleep around with all people, you know what, at the end of the day, after they sleep around with this person that doesn't care, you know, even if they're paying people for it, they start to yearn for somebody that actually loves them, actually cares for them. You know, you hear about it all the time, I suppose, where, you know, people, they're sleeping with prostitutes and whatnot, but then they start to want to have a relationship with that prostitute, and the prostitute's like, well, if you want to talk to me, I'm gonna have to charge you more time, right? and then people, you know, guys would be, you know, that they don't want that. They want actually somebody that cares about them and loves them and whatnot. Same with, you know, if you have all this money, you have all these friends, eventually you want friends that actually care about you and love you in the way that God intended and things like that. So these people, they're not happy. You know, don't believe the Hollywood lies. Don't believe the media where they show all these people. I mean, we know that it's all fake. It's like seeing somebody's Facebook feed. You know, it's all marketing. You know, that's why, like, same with the church Facebook feed. You know, obviously, I'm not going to show all the downtimes on Facebook. I'm going to show, like, you know, when church is full and when everything's happening and the soul winning numbers are up. I'm not going to take pictures of the auditorium when you guys don't come on a week and there's only like 10 people here. I'm not going to take a picture and say, hey, look, great, 10 people were in attendance. No, right? So it's the same with the media. You know, they're trying to tell a story that, hey, these people are so successful, these people are so happy. They're lying to you. You know, they're just showing half of the story. They're just showing you the good points, right? And they're trying to say that this is what you should strive for. Whereas at least the church, yeah, we're saying that, hey, people are happy here and everything, but we're still telling people the truth. We're telling them the Bible. So don't believe it. You know, the media, it's just like a Facebook feed. You're just seeing all the positive things as opposed to the things that really matter in life, which is what Solomon learned in his life. Now let's go over to 1 Kings. I wanted to show you here in 1 Kings 11, where Solomon, he took it to the extreme. But King Solomon loved many strange women together with the daughter of Pharaoh, women of the Moabites, Ammonites, Edomites, Zidonians, and Hittites, of the nations concerning which the Lord said unto the children of Israel, ye shall not go into them, neither shall they come in unto you, for surely they will turn away your heart after their gods. Solomon clave unto these in love. Look at this. And he had 700 wives, princesses, and 300 concubines, and his wives turned away his heart. For it came to pass when Solomon was old that his wives turned away his heart after other gods, and his heart was not perfect with the Lord his God, as was the heart of David his father. So again, so we read in 1 Kings 11, this is the last chapter of Solomon's life, where it doesn't end well in 1 Kings. And this is why a lot of people believe that Ecclesiastes was written after, because he's reflecting on all the things he's done and giving us knowledge in Ecclesiastes. So something that we can learn from Solomon is, you know, are we so foolish then to think that if we had what Solomon had, that we would be happy? You know, it's funny, like it's like God puts situations in the Bible because he knows how we're going to think. You know, he knows that one day our life's going to get hard. We're going to come under persecution. So what does he do? He gives us the example of Job, doesn't he? He says, here's Job. He's the most perfect man in the world. Because, you know, we get this idea that, like, hey, man, I'm serving God. I'm doing what's right. I'm trying to live for God. Why is my life so hard? And then you compare yourself to Job and you're like, okay, I'll just shut up now. You know, so it's like Job, who's like this perfect and upright man. There's nobody like him in the earth. And then he goes through all this trouble. You're like, wow, I've got that example to look to. So it's the same when we start thinking, man, I just wish I didn't have to do all this stuff for God. I wish I could just live it up. You know, I'd be so much happier if I could just go on another holiday. I'd be so much happier if I could, you know, just had a different wife, a wife that loved me, a wife that, you know, did something different. I just wish, like, my children weren't so like this. I wish my family, you know, I wish I could just enjoy this more. I wish I could just enjoy that. I wish I had the money to buy this or buy that or do that. Are we so foolish to think that we're wiser than Solomon? Like, it's like people think they see Solomon's example and they think, no, but if I was in that situation, I would be different. You know, I would be able to handle it. Really? So what's funny is that, you know, God did this experiment. Well, God allowed Solomon to do this experiment. But it's interesting that it's not just the fact that Solomon did this experiment, but he also made the wisest man that ever lived do this experiment to show that, hey, if you think you can handle what Solomon did, do you think you're wiser than Solomon? I mean, he's already telling you you're not wiser than Solomon because he's the wisest man that ever lived. Who are we to think, but man, if I just had that, I would be happy. It wouldn't be vanity to me. It wouldn't be vexation of spirit to me because I can handle it. No. Why do we think, why are we so foolish to think that if we just had something different, if something was just better in our lives, then it wouldn't be the same conclusion that Solomon is coming to? I mean, yes, Solomon got to enjoy a lot more than we did, but he's making a point to say, hey, you know, you think it's just a little bit better. I got to live it up all the way to here. I'm just telling you, this is the conclusion that I've come to. So let's go to that conclusion. Let's go to Ecclesiastes 12. And we'll read the whole chapter because I think it's a really great chapter. Ecclesiastes 12 says here, remember now thy creator in the days of thy youth, while the evil days come not, nor the years draw nigh when thou shalt say, I have no pleasure in them. While the sun or the light or the moon or the stars be not darkened, nor the clouds return after the rain. In the day when the keepers of the house shall tremble and the strong men shall bow themselves and the grinders cease because they are few and those that look out of the window be darkened and the doors shall be shut in the streets when the sound of the grinding is low and he shall rise up at the voice of the bird and all the daughters of music shall be brought low. Also when they shall be afraid of that which is high and fears shall be in the way and the almond tree shall flourish and the grasshopper shall be a burden and desire shall fail. Because man goeth to his long home, and the mourners go about the streets. Or ever the silver cord be loosed, or the golden bowl be broken, or the pitcher be broken at the fountain, or the wheel broken at the cistern. Then shall the dust return to the earth as it was, and the spirit shall return unto God who gave it. Vanity of vanity, saith the preacher, all is vanity. And moreover, because the preacher was wise, he still taught the people knowledge. Yea, he gave good heed, and sought out and set in order many proverbs. The preacher sought to find out acceptable words, and that which was written was upright, even words of truth. The words of the wise are as goads and as nails, fastened by the masters of assemblies, which are given from one shepherd. And further by these, my son, be admonished, of making many books there is no end, and much study is a weariness of the flesh. Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. For God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil. So let's just go over this chapter a bit more in depth, and then we'll make some conclusions there. It says here, remember now thy creator in the days of thy youth, while the evil days come not, nor the years draw nigh when thou shalt say, I have no pleasure in them. Now that's a great verse there. And you know, this verse always sticks with me because I was in a youth group once and this was the theme verse. I'm sure it's the theme verse for a lot of youth groups all over the world, right? Because they're trying to exhort young people to say, hey, you don't wait until after you graduate. You don't wait until you go to university. You don't wait until you're working a job. You don't wait until you're married. You don't wait until you've done the family and the children. And you don't wait until your business is done. You don't wait until you're old and you're retired and you've done everything you want to do. You don't wait after you've gone on holiday and used your whole life serving yourself to serve God. The Bible says here, remember now thy creator in the days of thy youth. Right now is the time to serve God, not later on, because everyone's got an excuse for why not to serve God. You know, when you're young, I'm too young. When you're in the middle, I'm too busy with work, with uni, with marriage, with children, with, you know, parents, then with grandchildren, you know, and then you're dead. So there's always an excuse not to serve God, and that's why God is exhorting us to remember now thy creator in the days of thy youth. In the days of thy youth, when your life, you can actually do something with your life. How many people do you see when they're old, they can't even walk, they don't even have the strength to walk door to door anymore, now they want to serve God. Well, what were they doing when they had the strength? When they were 20, when they were 30, when they were 40, what were they doing? Were they sowing their wild oats? Were they building a business? Were they trying to seek after their career? Hey, I'm not saying that you give those things up in order to serve God, but you need to make sure that you're in your life, you're doing it at the same time. There's no reason why. Hey, one of our responsibilities, man, is to provide for our family. So there's no reason why you can't serve God and provide for your family and also do the things that God expects of you. So you need to remember now thy Creator in the days of thy youth, while the evil days come not, nor the years draw nigh when thou shalt say, I have no pleasure in them. And it's just some beautiful analogies here in Ecclesiastes. And as I go through them, I'll just maybe explain to you what I think they are. While the sun or the light or the moon or the stars be not darkened, or the clouds return after the rain. So I think that's in some environmental things. In the day when the keepers of the house shall tremble. A lot of people think that the keepers of the house are your legs, right? The things that keep your body up and are able to put it on a stand, so that, you know, your knees start to tremble. Or some people think that the keepers of the house are your hands, right? Because they take care of your body. You know, you brush your teeth with your hands, you clean yourself with your hands, and they're starting to tremble. And the strong men shall bow themselves. So people who think the keepers of the house are the hands, I'll say the strong men are your legs, right? Because they're generally your strongest muscle in the body. Will start to bow and start to come over, or they think it's your back, you know, it starts to bend over. And the grinders cease, so that's obviously your teeth, they stop working, or they fall out, or, you know, nowadays you can get dentures and things like that, because they are few. And those that look out of the windows be darkened, so it's when your sight starts to fail and you can't see properly anymore. And the doors shall be shut in the streets when the sound of the grinding is low. So that, I don't know if that's your speech or your hearing. And he shall rise up at the voice of the bird, and all the daughters of music shall be brought low. So isn't it funny that even back then, you know, old people, they wake up really early in the morning. They rise up when the birds are chirping. And the daughters of music shall be brought low. So I'm not sure whether that's referring to, you know, when you listen to music, your hearing starts to fade as you get older. Also, when they shall be afraid of that which is high, and fears shall be in the way. Now, that is something. As you get older, you start to just fear things that you didn't fear when you were a kid. Man, I remember when I was younger, you know, when I was just in uni, and I used to do lion and dragon dance. So if you guys know the Chinese tradition, lion and dragon dance, you know, they come in, you know, you're at a restaurant during Chinese New Year, and these two guys in a costume come in and they start taking money off you, and they break up a cabbage and then throw it on everyone. So I used to do that for a Chinese organization. And one thing we got into was on the prop performances, where you're actually like jumping along the poles. Have you seen that? With who knows what I'm talking about? Nobody knows what, okay, a few people know. So basically, there's these two guys, you know, one person's holding the head and another person is the tail. So he's like underneath this tail and he's going on, and then they do that performance. But the more acrobatic guys would do prop performances, where there's actually these poles that are on these bases on the ground, and the performance is where you're actually jumping along these bases. And the bases that you're standing on are about this big. So the pole goes up. So this first one might be this big, and then it's a platform. And the next one, there'll be two, and then there's two platforms, and then they get higher and higher, and they go up and down, because it's meant to represent this lion that is like going over the hills and valleys, getting to, you know, how Chinese have those sorts of stories. So I used to do that, and my friend would be behind, and he'd pick me up on these poles, and I'd be jumping, and we'd be flying across these poles. And I just think, man, when I think back at the things I was doing, I'm like, man, I'm insane. I can't even... Like, I think, how did I not break my back? How did I not break my leg doing that? Because now when I think of doing it, I'm just like, oh man, I'm so scared being up here. But I used to jump up and all sorts of things doing that. Fear shall be in the way. The almond tree shall flourish, and the grasshopper shall be a burden. I wonder whether that almond tree flourishing is talking about the flowers of the almond tree, you know, your hair getting white. The grasshopper shall be a burden. I don't know what that's talking about. I'm not sure what the grasshopper is. And desire shall fail, so we know what that's talking about, you know, this sexual desire, because man goeth to his long home, and the mourners go about the streets. So I believe that's a reference to the funeral. You know, you die, you go back to God. It talks about the spirit going back to God. Hopefully you're saved, it will go to heaven. If you're not saved, it'll go to hell. And the mourners go about the streets. So that's the... I believe just after the funeral, you know, people going back home. Or ever the silver cord be loosed, so that's, I believe a lot of people think that's talking about your spinal cord. Or the golden bowl be broken, some people think that's talking about your brain, you know, you're not thinking straight anymore. Or the pitcher be broken at the fountain, or the wheel broken at the cistern. I don't know whether people think that's talking about the heart, because, you know, the heart just constantly is beating and pushing through this blood, whereas a wheel at a cistern, you know, it powers something like a windmill or something. and the water is flowing through it. Then shall the dust return to the earth as it was, and the spirit shall return unto God who gave it. Again, vanity of vanity, saith the preacher, all is vanity. And moreover, because the preacher was wise, he still taught the people knowledge. So you remember when Solomon was saying, I did all these things, but wisdom still remained with me. So even though he did these foolish things, the lessons that he learned from it, he wrote down. He wrote Proverbs. He wrote Ecclesiastes through the Spirit of God. He still taught the people knowledge. Yea, he gave good heed and sought out and set in order many proverbs. So this just goes to show, just like, you know, David made mistakes, you know, the Apostle Peter made mistakes, Solomon made mistakes, but look, they were still greatly used by God. You know, some of us have a past where we've made mistakes, and maybe those mistakes disqualify us from serving in the ministry in terms of being a bishop or a deacon. But that doesn't mean God can't use you to do great things, just like he still used Solomon to pen down a lot of wise sayings in the Bible. The preacher sought to find out acceptable words, and that which was written was upright, even words of truth. The words of the wise are as goads and as nails fastened by the masters of assemblies, which are given from one shepherd. That's an interesting passage there, saying that wise words are like goads and as nails. So if you don't know what a goad is like a sharp, pointy stick. So they will, like, you know, prod like the animals along, like maybe a goat or an ox or something. When they stop moving, a goad is like this stick that they just prod them with just to keep them going. And that's what God's word is a bit like, right? Because we're like these oxen, you know, because we're meant to be working for God, and we get lazy, right? We start, like, you know, chewing the food and we stop moving, or we start turning around and getting distracted. So God has to sometimes remind you and just poke you with something, you know, poke you with these wise words to get you moving again. And that's why it's important that you come along to church to hear these wise words, that you fellowship with other believers, because sometimes another believer is going to sharpen you a bit and say, you know what, you ought to be soul winning. You ought to get to church. You ought to do these things, because it's a wise word to say, get moving again. You know, get moving in the right direction. And as nails, so not only getting you moved in the right direction, but once you settle on something that is true, the wise words secure it down. If you think like a nail securing a tent, these wise words will fasten things down by the masters of assemblies, which are given from one shepherd. So it's interesting that these wise words that prod you along and give you stability, fasten you down, they all come from God. They all come from one shepherd. You know, wisdom comes from above, right? And further by these, my son, be admonished, of making many books there is no end, and much study is a weariness of the flesh. So then he gets to the conclusion. Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. So we learn about the life of Solomon. We see that Solomon had all the wisdom and all the honor, all the riches in the world. He then went out and just lived it up, you know, lived it up and tried everything to please his heart. And what was his conclusion? His conclusion was vanity of vanities, all his vanities. Because he realized the only thing that really matters in the end is what we do for God. And that's why he's saying, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter, fear God and keep his commandments. So I'm jumping all over the place, just trying to see what I've covered, what I haven't. Let's go to Psalm 73, and I'll just end on this point. Oh, before we turn there. So, you know, one thing that's interesting about Ecclesiastes 12:13. So one, we learn that the conclusion that Solomon came to after all these experiences is to fear God and keep his commandments. I just thought it was interesting how it's phrased here. It says, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Because Solomon didn't do all these things and just say, this is the conclusion of the whole matter. Isn't it interesting how he says, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter? And to me, the way that speaks to me, it's almost like some people won't hear. You know, some people, they'll see this conclusion and they won't hear with their spiritual ears. Yeah, sure, you're listening to the words now, but are you hearing it? Like Jesus says, he that hath ears to hear, let him hear. You know, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. And it's almost like Solomon here is saying, yeah, people are going to know this is here. They're going to know this is the conclusion. But are they going to hear it? Are they going to take it on board? or are they just going to hear it and then leave church the same as they came? Let us hear the conclusion, which is to fear God and keep his commandments. And you know, the reason why I decided to preach this today, because, you know, last night I was just thinking about these things and I was just thinking, man, you know what? Why does God just make it so hard to live right? You know, like, why? You know, because I was thinking, you know, it's like, why is it so hard to do what's right? Why is it so hard to want to do what's right? You know, and, you know, why is sin so tempting? You know, like, it's almost like, oh, it's so cruel that God, you know, that he gave, you know, we have these desires, we have this desire to sin, and yet it's so pleasurable to sin. You know, why is it so hard? And then I got talking and I'm like, it's not that pleasurable. You know, what am I talking about? Like, why am I thinking that sin is so pleasurable, that this is something I desire? I mean, I'm just thinking, like, have I not read the Bible? Have I not thought about Solomon? So I just started preaching Elizabeth in our bedroom, just this mini sermon, just saying, like, you know, like, this is why Solomon's there, because he did all these things. He enjoyed all this, and then he realized it was vanity and vexation of spirit. You know what? I think I'm going to tell the church this tomorrow. So I decided to write this, put this sermon together to let you guys know what I was thinking last night. So let's end on Psalm 73, because really this is the story of this psalmist, Asaph. We get some insight into Asaph, what sort of person he was, you know, and his thoughts here as he writes this psalm under the inspiration of the Holy Ghost. And the reason why I decided to preach this today, because sometimes we need to go to church to be reminded this. Because it's so easy for us to get carried about with the cares of this world. You know, even the things that I've been mentioning today, when we talk about family and friends and pleasures and holidays and businesses and things like that, we've all gone through it. You know, I'm not up here telling you guys that I'm not the same. Hey, we've all gone through it where we just get carried away with the things of this life. And sometimes we need a sermon like this just to wake us up again, you know, that goad, just to prod us in the right direction so that we'll remember, oh man, like, yeah, I gotta do something for God. I gotta make sure I actually do something meaningful with my life, because it's so easy to go in, week out, and before you know, 2016's over. And then week in, week out, you haven't done anything for God, you haven't gone soul winning, 2017's over, 2018's over, 2019's over. So we have to be reminded again and again and again to make sure that we are serving God. And this is why it's so important that you guys come to church. You know, not all of you here come to church every week, you know, and you don't get that reminder. And especially because we don't meet for church multiple times a week. We meet once a week. So if you miss a Sunday, I mean, you haven't talked to people here in 2 weeks. You miss two Sundays, that's 3 weeks, it's almost a month now. That's a long time to go. You know, I mean, even throughout the week, don't you guys already start to feel down, like your spirit, you're starting to get spiritually down. You need somebody to sort of kick you in the pants again and say, oh, and remind you, hey, man, I'm living for God. I'm not living for this job. I'm not living for this business. I'm not living for this. You know, I've got to remember to live for God. Look at what it says here in Psalm 73. It's such a beautiful psalm. It's you know, sometimes when you read Proverbs and you read Psalms, you just get so lost, like if you're not really familiar with what it says, and you're just like, oh man, like these phrases are so random, and these phrases, like, you know, how do I follow along with this? But when you read Psalm 73, there's just this really logical thought process. It's a real pleasure to read Psalm 73. So anyways, without further ado, I will read Psalm 73. Truly God is good to Israel, even to such as are of a clean heart. Isn't that the truth? Truly God is good to us, isn't he? Sometimes we got to go to church to remember that, right? Because sometimes we're out there and we start complaining about what we have. We start complaining about what our life is like, and we forget how good God has been to us. You know, he's given us life. He's given us breath. I mean, there's nobody in this auditorium that's disabled, that's in a wheelchair. I mean, that's something to be thankful of. You know, just because you don't have that boat, or you didn't get to go on that holiday, or you don't have that promotion, man, you've got the wrong perspective. You know, God is good for even giving us the opportunity to live, you know, giving us salvation. But as for me, my feet were almost gone. My steps had well nigh slipped, for I was envious at the foolish when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. So here is Asaph. He's looking at the prosperity of the wicked. He's looking at the prosperity of the foolish. and he's starting to envy this. You know, it's interesting that he says when he started to envy it, his feet weren't slipping. He said they'd already nice slipped. He's already slipped when he's envying the prosperity of the wicked. So it's not that you are envying the prosperity of the wicked and you're like, man, I'm starting to backslide. No, you are backslidden already when you start to envy the prosperity of the wicked, because that's not something we should do at all if we are walking in the Spirit. So you need to take heed to that and say, man, if I start envying these things, if I start desiring the prosperity of the wicked, hey, realize right now you're backslidden. You know, you need to get right with God and start heading in the right direction. For there are no bands in their death. So he's starting to look at these wicked and prosperous people and starting to envy them, saying there's no bands in their death. I don't know if that means like, you know, they die and they're healthy, you know, because maybe in those days it was really hard to get the nutrition that you needed. And these rich people, you know, they're strong and they're healthy. Their strength is firm. They are not troubled as other men. Man, they don't have a hard time like these other people that I see. Neither are they plagued like other men. They didn't even suffer from the same debilitations that other people would have. They look all healthy and everything like that. I guess you can't really say that about the Hollywood whores and whoremongers, right? Because they are plagued. You just can't see it on the front. You know, people even think now that, you know, does Bill Clinton have AIDS? You know, because he looks so famished and everything like that. He's got all the symptoms of somebody who has AIDS. You know, maybe because he's been sleeping with all these women all his life. You know, we only found out about Monica Lewinsky. What about all the others? You know. Anyways, therefore, pride compasseth them about as a chain, violence covereth them as a garment. So because they have it so good, he's saying here, therefore, they're so lifted up with pride. And, you know, they kill and destroy, they start all these wars, they fund all the wars and make money from all the wars. They don't even care. They don't even hide it away in their closet. They're covered with this violence. It reminds me of, you know, like a lot of the things that Alex Jones tries to reveal and, you know, like Ben Swan and all these things. All the information is out there. These rich people, these banksters and whatnot, they're so proud and lofty that they don't even try and hide it. You know, they build stones in the, you know, the Georgia stones saying, this is our plans. We want to reduce the population by half and we want to take women out of the home and we want to teach your children and we all this stuff. We want to print money into oblivion. They're not even hiding this stuff anymore. All the violence and theft from us, they don't even hide it. They put it all out there in the open. This is why people have to wake up. You know, God's people have to wake up, and hopefully the society will wake up, because they will only have power over us as long as we're ignorant. Their eyes stand out with fatness. They have more than heart could wish. They are corrupt and speak wickedly concerning oppression. They speak loftily, so they just say whatever they want. They set their mouth against the heavens, and their tongue walketh through the earth. So not only are they blaspheming against God, are they speaking against God in heaven? Maybe because they say, oh, look at, like Nebuchadnezzar, I look at this kingdom that I've built, look at all, what I've done, you know, without God. And their tongue walketh through the earth. When I think of this verse, it reminds me of like conferences. You know, these rich people, like, you know, who's that guy, Robert Kiyosaki, Rich Dad, Poor Dad? You know, they go around preaching these conferences, telling people how to be rich, telling people how to seek after money, telling people not to serve God, serve yourself. This is how you do it. You'll make it happen if you just believe in yourself and work hard. And preaching that philosophy, not Solomon's philosophy, which is fear God and keep his commandments. They're just saying, hey, if you do the right thing and you're smart with your money, you can be rich and retire early. And their tongue walketh through the earth. Therefore his people return hither, and waters of a full cup are wrung out to them. I'm not 100% sure what that verse means. And they say, how doth God know, and is there knowledge in the Most High? So you see how they're so proud that they start to think, oh, what's God going to do about it? He's not going to do anything about this. Behold, these are the ungodly who prosper in the world. They increase in riches. Verily, I have cleansed. Now this is Asaph saying this. He says, verily, truly, I have cleansed my heart in vain and washed my hands in innocency. For all the day long have I been plagued and chastened every morning. So he's starting to say here, man, like, why am I living? He's starting to lose his perspective as he envies the prosperity of the wicked. He starts to say, man, why am I even living right? Why am I even trying to live right? If I'm trying to live right And man, I'm just plagued for all the day long. Have I been plagued and chastened every morning? My life is so hard. What is even the point of doing what's right? He's also losing the perspective as well, because look at what he says in verse 13. He says, verily, I have cleansed my heart in vain. So even he's starting to think, hey, it's him. Is he starting to think that he's getting these blessings from? You know, it's him that thinks that he's saving himself, that he's cleaning himself. Hey, what can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. God is what cleanses us, not us. So it's like he's getting this wrong perspective. He's starting to look inwardly rather than outwardly towards God. If I say I will speak thus, behold, I should offend against the generation of thy children. When I thought to know this, it was too painful for me. So he's struggling with this of, oh man, like what's the point of all this? They've got it so good. But if I start telling people that, I'm gonna lead their children astray if I start thinking these things. And it was just too painful to think about. But look here in verse 17. Until I went into the sanctuary of God, then understood I their end. Now, obviously, Asaph is going to the Old Testament temple, but for us in the New Testament, it's coming into the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth. So Asaph gets his head straightened on when he comes into the house of God to get the right perspective and to be reminded and to be prodded and fastened with the wise words of the Bible. Surely thou didst set them in slippery places. Thou castest them down into destruction. So is he only talking here about their end in terms of them going to hell? Or maybe it's not, because how many people do we hear about, you know, that are rich, that have it all going, but at the end of their life, they're so depressed, they commit suicide, they don't have real friends, they're in slippery places, they don't have stability, they don't know what they believe, they don't know what's happening after they leave this world. They don't have the same hope and assurance and what's fastening us and giving us that anchor of the soul like Jesus Christ gives us. They don't have that. And this is what he's realizing. He's like, wait, he's starting to realize, wait a second, these people don't have it as good as they lead us to believe. How are they brought into desolation? You know, it makes me think about people that are just really depressed all the time. They don't have the joy that we have. As in a moment, they are utterly consumed with terrors. See, God has not given us the spirit of fear, but somebody that's just lived for themselves and they're starting to realize, hey, these riches are temporary. I don't know what's happening after I live. You know, I don't really have real friends. They're going to start to have some fear there. As a dream when one awaketh, so, O Lord, when thou awakest, thou shalt despise their image. They don't have the love of God for them. Thus my heart was grieved, and I was pricked in my reins. So now he's getting convicted now by his conscience. My heart was grieved and I was pricked in my reins. I wonder if he was pricked by that goad, you know, the goad that we were talking about before. So foolish was I and ignorant. See, and that's generally one of the main problems of why you start thinking the wrong way, why you start having the wrong perspective and why you start having the wrong thoughts. It's because of ignorance. You know, if you're not reading your Bible and studying your Bible, you're going to start thinking like Asaph. You know, yeah, he went into the sanctuary and got reminded, but if you get away from the sanctuary, hey, during the week, you need to be reminded to have the right frame of mind. So foolish was I and ignorant. I was as a beast before thee. So Asaph is saying here, I'm like this stupid animal before God. You know, that's what we are when we start to think like Asaph. You know, we start to think, you know, we start envying the prosperity of the wicked. We're a stupid animal as well. You know, we're foolish and ignorant, like Asaph is admitting here before us. Nevertheless, I am continually with thee. Thou hast holden me by thy right hand, by my right hand. Thou shalt guide me with thy counsel, and afterward receive me to glory. Whom have I in heaven but thee? And there is none upon earth that I desire beside thee. So you see, when he gets his head on straight, he gets his perspective right, He comes to the house of God. He's reminded, he's prodded with these goads and fastened with those nails. He realizes, huh, I've got nothing really in this life besides God. And really, that's the only thing I really want, because that's the only thing that's not vain and vexation of spirit. My flesh and my heart faileth, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. Yeah, we're gonna fall. Yeah, we're not perfect. And I'm not up here trying to tell you that I never experienced. Of course, I'm like this too. I'm just like you guys. you know, yes, we fail, and we need the grace of God to give us that strength so that we can do what is right. For lo, they that are far from thee shall perish. Thou hast destroyed all them that go a-whoring from thee. But it is good for me to draw near to the Lord. I have put my trust in the Lord God, that I may declare all thy works. So just a few conclusions here. Is at the end here, he says, it's good for me to draw near to God. So, you know, we in the world, we start thinking, hey, it would be great if I could do this. It'd be good if I did this. But we have to realize the only thing good for us is that we serve God, that we fear God and keep his commandments. We need to realize that is good. That is good for us. That is how you actually love yourself, right? And do what's right for yourself, do what's right for other people, is you draw near to God. I have put trust in the Lord that I may declare all thy works. So what was Asaph's response when he heard the conclusion of the whole matter and he realized that it's good and right for him to serve the Lord, to fear God and keep his commandments? He then was willing to declare all God's works. And that's why the natural response when you realize this, when you realize how much God loves you, that God, remember at the very first verse, he says, the Lord God is good, that you would want to then go out and tell people about it. So it just makes me think, you know, if you don't have a desire to go out and tell people about the Lord Jesus Christ, maybe it's because you don't realize this yet. You don't realize yet how much God has done for you. You don't realize yet how good God is to you. You don't realize yet that seeking anything else in this life is just vanity and vexation of spirit. Because once you do, that's when you're willing to really realize, hey man, I got to invest some of my life doing something that actually matters, as opposed to investing my life in things that God, that does not matter. So let's just go back to Ecclesiastes 12 and just end on this thought. So he says here in verse 13, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. Are you going to hear that today? You know, or are you just going to walk out, not take this into account, and just be the same person that you do? I hope this reminder, you know, prodded you in the right direction and fastened you down a bit. But hey, let's hear the conclusion of the matter, you know, both physically and also spiritually. All right, let's sing a song just to finish up. That's all I've got. Before we sing, let's just pray. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you for the reminder of how much you love us. Lord, I pray that you'd give us all the wisdom of Solomon. Lord, even just a portion of it, that we might realize the vain things in our life. And Lord, that we would use our time and our talents to serve you. Lord, you've been so good to us. You've given us salvation. You've given us a home in heaven. We have assurance because of the blood of Jesus Christ. And Lord, not only that, you've given us so many other blessings that if we were truly to sit down and think about all the things that we get to enjoy and do in this life, Lord, that they would fill a multitude of books of all the experiences that we have. And yet, Lord, in our flesh, it's so hard to prioritize you. It's so hard to do what's right. I pray, Lord, that you'd give everyone here the grace to put you first, that you might have in all things the preeminence. Thank you, Lord, for the Lord Jesus. Thank you for your grace. And thank you for these words that you've given us in your Bible, that you've not left us without light. You've not left us without guidance. I pray, Lord, that we would take heed to these spiritual goads and nails, that they may get us moving again. We pray and ask in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, let's finish on this song. Let's sing, Will Jesus Find Us Watching? All right, sing it out. When Jesus comes to reward his servants, whether it be noon or night, faithful to him will he find us watching, with our lamps all trimmed and bright. Oh, can we say we are ready, brother, ready for the soul's bright home? Say, will he find you and me still watching, waiting, waiting when the Lord shall come? If at the dawn of the early morning he shall call us one by one, when to the Lord we restore our talents, will he answer thee, well done? Oh, can we say we are ready, brother, ready for the soul's bright home? Say, will he find you and me still watching, waiting, waiting when the Lord shall come? Blessed are those whom the Lord finds watching, in his glory they shall share. If he shall come at the dawn or midnight, will he find us watching there? Oh, can we say we are ready, brother, ready for the soul's bright home? Say, will he find you and me still watching, waiting, waiting when the Lord shall come? All right, let's start getting ready for dinner.